The aftermath of Mohsen Fakhrizadeh's assassination indicates a carefully planned attack. But was it a high-tech killing, as Iranian officials claim, or sloppy Iranian security? As Hollywood graphically depicts, the technology exists. In Breaking Bad, the key fob is the trigger, just meters from the gun. In the real world, in Iran, hypothetically possible.
The challenge is in target acquisition. How does the autonomous device actually work out what it's supposed to be shooting?
Typically, automated machine guns are used as sentries, like the DMZ between North and South Korea. In an assassination, more technology is needed to confirm the target, creating multiple risks.
If you're putting lots of very expensive communication relays, so satellite uplinks and this kind of thing, into a device like that, then you are handing that technology to your enemy. And you're also creating a signature that could be detected by the security services if it needed to be in place and left there for a long period of time. So you're more likely to find that it's being controlled from a fairly close proximity, but that could still be a few kilometers.
The majority of nuclear scientists assassinated in Iran, and there have been several over the past decade, have generally been low-tech gunmen or bombers on motorbikes. Fakhrizadeh's assassination appears to be an embarrassment for Iran's security services. He was a protected and prized scientist. However, blaming Israel, as Iran has, claiming sophisticated technology was used in the killing, may mollify angry Iranians, but it won't gain international credibility without evidence. Israeli Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu's office will not comment, but at least two Israeli ministers saying they had no idea who killed Fakhrizadeh.
We have to be very careful because witnesses are not always reliable in high-stress situations. I think we would want the Iranians to present some more evidence before we made any assumptions.
No one is saying it didn't happen as Iran claims. Simply, Tehran has yet to prove its case. Nick Robertson, CNN, London.
Washington Post journalist Jason Rezaian spent 544 days unjustly imprisoned by Iranian authorities until his release in January of 2016. He says the current scenario will test the man who was America's vice president when the Iran deal was inked and who is now headed for the top job. Rezaian writes, Iran's political establishment faces a serious test of will, so will Joe Biden. Jason joining us now. Let's start with the very latest details on this assassination. And I don't want to back into the whys and the what happens next. A high-tech killing, as Iranian media claim, or sloppy Iranian security, Jason? And if it was a high-tech targeted assassination, what do you make of these new details reported by local media of a remotely operated machine gun and a remotely detonated car?
Well, Becky, it's a great question. And as somebody who spent a year and a half sitting in Iranian prison, being accused of most fabulous crimes imaginable, and continuing to be the target of the same propaganda apparatus that puts out this information, I think the likelihood of some very sophisticated, never-before-seen drone-type weapon being the culprit in this case is pretty far-fetched. If you look at other Iranian state media reports this week, they claim to have a COVID vaccine that's coming out just in a matter of days that they're going to name after this nuclear scientist, Mohsen Fakhrizadeh, because they say that he was the key engineer in helping to create this vaccine. We cannot take Iranian media proclamations at face value. And I think that the reality here is that this is another embarrassing moment for Iran's security apparatus that has not been able to secure their own soil.
Fascinating. And it's great to have you on. Your insight is invaluable for all the reasons that you just pointed out. Jason, the head of Iran's Strategic Council on Foreign Relations, pointing out that, quote, The Islamic Republic of Iran will give decisive answers to the criminals who took our martyr from the Iranian nation. What happens next in the short term?
Becky, I think that in all likelihood, we won't see any grand displays of Iranian retaliation in the short term. I think that they'll focus on cyber attacks, which is something that they're getting, you know, increasingly better at. But, you know, in this moment where there is, you know, such a short period of time between now and the inauguration of Joe Biden, and competing factions within the Iranian regime want to see different outcomes. You know, one faction, the Revolutionary Guard Corps, would like to see Iran retreat further and not engage with the West. But the current president, who still has another 6 months before the next election, would like to re-engage with the U.S. And the rest of the world, because Iran's economy is on the brink of collapse.
Let's talk about then where we are at and what it is that Joe Biden takes on as far as the Iran file is concerned. The American senator and one of the most powerful people in Washington on foreign policy, Chris Murphy, tweeting today, and I quote, "When Trump came into office, Iran's breakout time to a nuclear weapon was 12 months. Today, it's 2 months. When Trump came into office, Iran had 300 kilograms of enriched uranium. Today, they have 2,400 kilograms. That, says Chris Murphy, is the definition of failure. You, though, have just pointed out that Iran's economy is on its knees, which to the Trump administration is the definition of a successful maximum pressure campaign. So what is the bottom line here for Joe Biden and any future negotiations?
You know, I think that the fact is that, you know, we've learned that bringing the Iranian economy to the brink has not succeeded in curtailing their other activities. In fact, it's encouraged them to do more defensive action and increase their nuclear output, as we've seen over the last 2 years. So I think that the real tricky calculation here is, how do you engage Iran, pressure Iran through measures that hurt their top officials, while at the same time encouraging them to modify their behavior, be more open to the outside world, more transparent, better to their own citizenry. The human rights record in Iran is deplorable. Stop taking foreign nationals hostage and using them as leverage in your political negotiations with the rest of the world. Essentially, to act like other countries do. If you want to be treated like the rest of the world, act like the rest of the world. At the same time, the rest of the world, led by the United States, has increasingly treated Iran as some kind of a pariah, very different than it does other nations. And I think we just need to throw out the double standards, start fresh, understand that there are issues that need to be addressed, the most important one being that Iran can never have a nuclear weapon. But under the 2015 deal, that was pretty much a foregone conclusion that they would never get one. So, you know, we're kind of back at point zero.